How's it going, guys? Michael here. We'll be doing a book review on Krieg. So spoiler-free section, obviously. We'll start out there. I love this book. It is a fantastic book. And I do deeply regret that we do not have more. You know, do something real quick. I wish there was more of this book. You know, really, really wish there's more of it. Straight now, we're going to get into spoilers. So, the book, if I recall, I'm not trying to open it up to start reading. If I recall, it opens up with Von Buren, who is an Inquisitor. Remember, this is a spoiler section, so be all over the fucking place. I'm going to discuss this for at least 10 minutes. I can probably do it way less, but I'm going to discuss it for 10 minutes. So, from what I ascertained by the end of the video, Von Buren was sent to investigate the Death Corps of Krieg. Maybe. In the beginning of the book, I remember he was leading refugees and shit. It kind of seemed like he was, kind of seemed like he was there to investigate what happens later in the book. Last warning, spoilers. Which is that there turns out to be nukes on the planet, or in this hive specifically named, I'd say Arngrad or something. Probably not how it's said, but whatever. So he's either there to investigate the nukes, or he's just there to investigate the Krieg themselves. This is the whole thing of the book. On Arngrad, whatever, it was an orc invasion. Let me preface this. The book kind of works in two sections. One is the invasion of orcs invading Arngrad, or whatever. There's Cadians there. This is after the fall of Cadia. So Cadians are kind of rare, you know, because they don't have a fucking planet to keep to keep breeding and shit. So there's Cadians there. They're losing. Cadians are proud. They're honorable. They're some of the finest guardsmen there are in the fucking galaxy. They're not the best. That's what I think is kind of the thing of this book. They're not the best guardsmen. And it also, this book goes well with the new rules, being that the Death Corps of Krieg costs more than a Cadian squad. Simple fact of the matter is, fucking Krieg soldiers are built different. And this book even shows that. The Cadians are the best of the best, however, Death Corps of Krieg are better. So the other half of the book is going back to the Civil War of Krieg. So, I swear they say like 15 millennia ago or some dumb shit like that. I don't know. It was forever ago. And it follows Colonel Yurgin, which, if you like Death Corps of Krieg, you know that name. There's also a very interesting thing in this book regarding him. But yeah, you're following Colonel Yurgin and him being there when the, basically when Krieg, you know, separates. Can't remember the planetary governor's name who fucked shit up. I will say this though, that whole arc of the Krieg Civil War wasn't as good as it could have been. I mostly mean this from the fighting stance of it. And they don't seem super Kriegish at first. It seems to be more of Colonel Yurgin. Colonel Yurgin isn't even what you would fully expect of the originator of the Death Corps of Krieg. He's just a really devout worshiper of the Emperor. And, you know, there goes through the thing where the other people, the other side, the people that are rebelling, you know, they say crazy shit to him like, you know, they kill our children, you know, we ship our children off to die for this guy, and, you know, if he's so powerful, you know, why didn't he smite us down, and shit like, way later in the book, like, it's like several years into the war, you know, they have like a box meeting or some shit, and the enemy general says to Colonel Yurgin, like, oh, you expected me to be, you know, mutated, hunchbacked, and deformed and all that, but I'm not, I'm still just a person. You know, to me, that goes back to the whole thing that the fucking Emperor is like, I'm not a god, I'm just a person. Super awesome person, but he's not to be a deity. But, no, the Imperial Man did that anyway. Yeah, so that's the two sides of the book. But yeah, so you start with Von Buren. I feel like he's there to investigate Creed, but he's also there to investigate the nukes on Ehrengreit or something. Because it's lost tech. So nukes are like from the old age where technology is super powerful, etc., etc. And it's really interesting that nuclear bombs are always coming up as a theme, even though like I've heard about other shit from the dark age of technology that's like a million times more scary than just nuclear bombs, but whatever. Just I guess probably like the most common, the most weak, probably like the weakest fucking dark technology or some shit. There's Von Buren. He starts out with him leading some people up to the surface. They're down at the lower levels fighting mutants and all that shit, and he's trying to lead people up. And then you get to the top, and there's Sergeant Rennick. She's a female Cadian female sergeant in the Cadian group. She's cool. Can't say much for her perspective, but she does have a very good ending, like a 10 out of 10 fucking ending to her story. You know, she's proud, you know, headstrong, whatever. But they're losing, and that's a problem to her. That's a problem to all the Cadians. They're losing the war to the orcs. There's about 2,000 Cadians left or something, or maybe 25 or something like that. Maybe even 18. Numbered all over the place. What ends up happening is a colonel ends up coming down from Death Corps of Krieg, and he brings with him 5,000 Death Corps of Krieg troopers, and it describes that the Krieg, you know, they work throughout the entire fucking night. You know, unloading basilisks, they bring some Bane Blades, demolisher Lemurus tanks. They do all this all through the fucking night, as, you know, the Cadians go to bed and whatever, you know. Because the fight is over during the day, but the Kriegsmen, they landed, they got to work immediately, it worked all night, setting all this shit up. And I believe it's like as the sun's fucking rising or some shit, you know, Sergeant Rennick, because I'm pretty sure it was all from her perspective, was expecting them to go to bed, and they don't. They go out like miles in front of all the shit they built up in the like safe area, because Ehrengreit, the city, is controlled by the orcs. So they go out there and they start digging. They start digging their fucking holes and all that. And the orcs eventually take notes. They start shooting at them, but the Kriegsmen keep digging. They might even get attacked, and they fight them off, and then they just keep digging the trenches. And they finish the trench network. But, while all this, there's like scenes of like describing the Krieg as like, oh, are they even fucking people? I mean, we don't see their face. They won't talk to us. They give very acceptable answers when asked questions. I think there's a thing about because even Van Buren stops some Kriegs and wants to ask them a bunch of questions, you know, trying to rattle them a little bit if they don't get rattled. But he knew this. That's the thing. He knows this, and then he is older. He's an older man, like 70s to 100 or some shit probably. Getting ready to retire, and this is supposed to be his last hurrah. But he has an understudy named Inquisitor Farron or something, he's supposed to replace him. And that guy's ambitious and kind of more, he's more what you expect from an Inquisitor, like kind of a dick. And he tries to question the Kriegsmen, but he's disturbed by them. He's like, yeah, there's nothing wrong with these guys, they give him perfect answers and shit. But there's something off about them. Why do they wear masks? Are they mutants? Because everybody heard about some person waiting past named Inquisitor somebody. He was the first person who went to Krieg when Krieg was brought back into the fold after the war. And how she described it, how it's a death land. Nobody can even like go outside without your fucking skin boiling off and shit. Without wearing all this heavy shit and the gas masks and all that. I have another thought. I don't want to lose this thought, but but yeah, so they dig the trenches, you know, and Sergeant Rennick and all them, they're embarrassed. Like there's something wrong with them. It's like they're looking down on the Cadians, you know, the proud, best of the best in the fucking universe, Cadians. One of her soldiers tries to get into a fight with a Krieg soldier because he won't say more than like a single word answer to him. And he thinks they're looking down on him, and she ends up drilling her soldiers, like, I guess all day or some shit. Like, we're disciplined too, and all that. And basically, the whole war, especially from Rennick's perspective on Ehrengreit, is a lot of them trying to keep up with the Krieg soldiers and just not being able to because they're just not built like that. Sergeant Rennick herself, she does a pretty good job, but they're not the same. They're not the same kind of people. A lot of the book is, are these people. There's later on where they do some missions, they go into the city, they fight and all that, and, you know, Sergeant Rennick specifically sees, you know, Kree soldiers die, and then, like, instead of saying a prayer or, you know, recovering the comrades' bodies, you know, they'll just crouch down, take another, their power packs, weapons, and anything else useful. And then everything but the mask itself, they don't take the mask. And then they'll leave. And just leave the body there where it fell. I want to talk more about the colonel that lands on Arengrad. He's very straight to the point. He gets there, there's people that outrank him there, but he's just like, hey, you guys are fucking losing. I don't need briefed on what's going on. I know what's going on. I already read what the fuck's going on. And this is what I'm going to do about it. This is what we do. We're good at it. And they never point out specifically, but I think it's pretty clear that the Kree are there on Arengrad. Because one, hey, you already got the best of the best out there. The shortest space marine, you got Cadians in. They're losing. So who do you send in when the Cadians lose? You send in the Kree. The best guardsman. Motherfucking best guardsman. I think it's a thing of they knew there were nuclear bombs there on that city. And okay, yeah, no, I'm remembering now that was part of Van Buren's investigation. He definitely did know there were nukes there on the planet. And it was that the planetary governor had built them up with good intentions. He had built them up to, you know, just in case anything happened, hey, we got fucking nukes here. And then, of course, orcs attack. And he's like, well, I really don't want to use nukes, it's going to, like, fucking raise my planet, so let's not do that. But they were basically under the city. Later on, very cool scene, Van Bruin ends up going in a Hadrian's drill down under the earth with some with 9 grenadiers, which are, like, veterans, regarding them. They're guardian veterans. Don't got a model anymore, though. That sucks. Anyway, I'm going to, so, like, tabletop-wise, you probably use your old grenadiers as Karskakin or Scions now. There are, I don't even think there is any Guardsman veteran models or units anymore. Ninth or whatever. But he goes down there, he finds the nukes. Long story short, a grenadier ends up staying behind to set the nukes off. And he does set them off. With no remorse. That's a thing of, in the book. Like I said, a really big thing in the book is that the Kree don't mind dying, but because the Kree are atoning for their sin of having a civil war long, long ago. And that is what Colonel Gurton had set up. Is that, yeah, it's right here. In life, we all have much to be ashamed of. Atonement is achievable through death. No, that's not it, but that's still a good quote. It's that, you know, we fucked up so long ago by letting our people become soft. That's something, you know, something that Colonel Yurden also says at some point. He's like, if I knew, you know, all the aristocrats and everybody would get soft like this, thinking everything's fucking sweet because nothing happens here, he said he would have drove an entire ship of forts directly into their capital city. It dropped it, crash landed them there just so everybody could, you know, experience war. And something Sergeant Riddick says later at the end of her arc, another big spoiler, she ends up dying. She fights, like, from the start to the fucking end, she's fighting. She's a Cadian sergeant. Very good soldier. But she gets caught at the tailwind blast of a nuclear bomb. But she does live. She gets off of Arengrad afterwards, and she gets assigned to a new Cadian unit because her unit was decimated. Because, like, they had 2,000 to start when the Kree got there, but by the end of that, probably hundreds of people left. Hundreds of Cadians, maybe. But she goes to a new unit, some other Cadian unit. She gets a squad, but she doesn't feel like them. She doesn't feel that bond of being like a Cadian anymore, in a way. And she doesn't admit it till the very end, but she's dying. she has to, she got fucked up. The nuclear bomb mutated her somehow. She's definitely dying. And she ends up sacrificing herself for a new squad. Like, there was a point where she got saved during the war on Arengrad by a Death Rider of Kree again. She remembers, you know, the guy charged, and she thought it was like, oh, this is courageous, he's brave. The guy's, he's brave as shit. He charged this orc on his bike with his, which is, you know, a horse and a lance, and they killed each other. He was brave. The Landar's like, no, he wasn't brave. He's just, he's doing his duty. Like, he, there was no bravery or anything about that. She says it specifically. I could probably find it in here. But there was no bravery or anything like that about it. It's just, he did what he was supposed to do. And, you know, his friend just walked up his body, stripped his shit, and left him there afterwards. You know, something Sergeant Riddick says is that that the Creek saw it more clearly than all of them did. That in life, war, in death, peace, in life, shame, in death, and then it cuts off, but it's atonement. When you die, you atone for your sins. But, you know, that's one thing I really like about Warhammer specifically. It's so fucking interesting, is that, you know, I'm communist, I'm sure I've discussed this plenty of times in other videos, and if you haven't, hey, welcome. But it's very interesting that they make fascism seem good, in a way, in Warhammer. It's not even, like, fully fascism either, because women have, like, a very prominent role in Warhammer society, but it's where there's a certain... 40,000 years into the 4,000 millennia in the future, there's only war. And very interesting when life sucks, but there's like a nobility to like fighting and dying. Like being one person among trillions and fighting and dying for some cause. And that being a zealot for this guy named the Emperor, who for all intents and purposes is like, hey, don't fucking worship me. Technology is the way. Technology is the future. But then in the future, without him there at the helm, they all revert back to technology bad. Now, technology bad, and some of it is really good, and should be revered and worshipped. And you rub sacred oils on it and pray to it. You pray to your gun. You pray to it that it works well because it has a spirit, machine spirit in it. And the God Emperor... Instead of just being the emperor or leader of mankind, he's the god emperor. Which, you know, understandable, is understandable when he tells you I'm not a god, I'm just a fucking person. You might want to listen to him. I believe he was like the first person ever, too. It's really weird how that works. Anyways, yeah, so the Creed, right? They're, the whole book is about getting into more deeper spoilers. I want to say more about Colonel Yarden, but I can't. But like Colonel Yarden, he does a thing. They try to arrest him in the beginning. He doesn't allow him to. He goes over there. He flies his troopers back onto a planet. I think it's called Farengard. The planet they basically garrison up in. There's a Archmagos named Garel, and him and Yarden are like this because they're both the only two people to understand that. Hey, we're one. No, Astromaterium regiment and a city versus an entire fucking planet of traitors. But they make it work, and Grail like immediately starts digging under the planet or under the city. He's like, I mean, there's not shit up here. The person who wins is the person who. This is a long siege, and whoever lasts longer wins. He finds the nukes, he sets them up, he tells Jordan about them, and Archimagus Grail is very like straightforward to the point. He's like, this is what we need to do. There's a whole thing where Colonel Yarden has a daughter and she gets captured and she's just one soldier. And something also that Yarden constantly fucking says is that he's just one soldier. Which I think is interesting, adding to some other shit that I still do not want to forget to mention. But that is one of two of Yarden's sins. Is one, he ends up setting off nukes. He kills his planet. He loves Creek. He loves his people. However, they're fucking traitors. They're a bunch of possibly leaning towards chaos worshippers. They weren't. They just want freedom. But they're traitors. They're traitors to the Empire. The Emperor of Man. They're traitors to mankind in itself by being selfish and soft. Because they had it good and they want to keep it to themselves. They don't want to help anybody else. Artists And one of Jordan's sins, as he calls it, is that he nuked everybody. He killed every last fucking person. He'd have to nuke those long, many years of fighting. And Jordan gets old, tired, slow. He always fights from the front. But he can't because he's old. In his last 8 months where he's on his deathbed and shit. You know, he's reminiscing about 8 months ago when he had his final battle. And he's like, oh, it was like yesterday. And then there's some, like, kind of, like, tones of, like, Israel manipulating everything. And he's not, like, I'm as loyal as can be. Yeah, and Jordan ends up dying on his deathbed in a few days, I think. Or it was a few hours before his death. He finally gives Grell the okay to give a second sin. And it's called the Viete Womb or something. And from my understanding of this, so they don't explain it directly in the book. It's very played around. This is like one of the biggest spoilers in the book. The Viete Womb, from what I understand, allows somebody to have a baby within like a few months. It's basically cloning. Cloning, right? You're basically cloning people. And then by the time they're fucking like, I don't know, like a couple years old, maybe 6, 7, 8, they're already like 16. That's always thing been in other Creed books and shit, is that they're young. Like if you do see a Kriegsman face, they're young as fuck. But this brought up a very good question, because we've always known that they're kind of like clones of each other. Not exactly. They're like a lot like Boba Fett, you know, and the clone troopers where like, oh, there's kind of a, there's some original copies out there or something, and everybody's sort of a descendant of those original copies. But something that happens at the end in Feringrad, like the modern times thing, is that Inquisitor Faring, because you remember I'm talking about how he's suspicious of the Krieg, he made some Kriegsmen take off their mask. He's like, cause he angles it, because there's quite a few times where people are like, oh, you guys heretical, you know, you used forbidden weapons back in the past, so how do I know you're not heretical now? How come, what if you're mutated because you use unheretical weapons? And then Faring angles it like that and makes them show him their face. And it cuts off. And we know he's shocked by what he saw. But Inquisitor Von Bruin, his basically his mentor from the entire book, because he ends up becoming an Inquisitor working with him, because he does escape the nuclear blast, all that shit, whatever. He ends up working with him for like 15 years later. And he understands that the Krieg is necessary, that their sin is minor in comparison to what they do for the Empire of Man, and how many people have died for the Empire, and how hard they work, and that the Empire would not be as it is without the sacrifices that Krieg has made. That the strongest, the best, unquestionably, the Guardsmen have made, which is the Death Corps of Krieg. So back to the Viete Womb and what Faring saw. And then here's the last piece of the puzzle, and I'll let you think about it yourself. So the original Colonel, and there's one big thing. So there's Colonel Jordan, and then because Colonel Jordan was the highest ranking person of the loyalists, right, the Empire loyal soldiers, he was a colonel. He never, you know, he was leading the ship. He didn't become a general or anything. So even later, that colonel who came to the modern timeline, basically, he was a colonel. He was the highest ranking rank there seems to be in Krieg, is nobody goes past colonel. Which I don't know what a marshal is, but that's like the tabletop unit of it. And I don't know if that's like an equivalent of a colonel. But nobody in Krieg seemingly goes past the rank of colonel. Because nobody's going to outrank Jordan. Even the planetary governor was a colonel. That was when Inquisitor, whoever, first made contact with Krieg, they were a colonel. But the Viete Womb, there's the cloning. It was Jordan's final sin, is that he's like, for us to finish off this war, even though we nuked the whole planet to kill off the traitors, there's still traitors out there. We need more people. We need more resources. So his final sin was giving Grell the okay to start basically cloning people so they have more men. And they also, like in the last years, established the Def Corps of Krieg and the harsh training they had to undergo. And after the nukes is when that all started. And the first batch of people he saw, first batch of Krieg's men he saw, you know, they were perfect. He'd question them. And we do it to, you know, we fight to atone for our people's sins, for the sin of the of turning our back on the emperor. You know, in death there's atonement, in life there's shame, shit like that. The very first batch of Krieg's men were already on that shit. This was before the cloning, because Jurgen was still around, etc. I don't know how much more I can dance about it. But, so the Inquisitor first touched down on Krieg after the war, after the Krieg's men, the Loyalists, secured the planet. And they recontacted us from the military, and was like, hey, you know, we fucking, we did it. You know, we won. We won for the Emperor, and we're ready with like 20 fucking regiments of Astra Militarum. And I know it's described, but I don't remember if it's this book or other ones, but like the fucking nobles on Terra's like fucking jaws drop. They're like, you have how many fucking guardsmen ready to fight? This one planet has how many goddamn people ready to fight? They're like, how's that fucking possible? You know how it's possible. You already set it up with the Viete Arlinde. But yeah, so the Inquisitor, the first one who gets the Krieg to inspect them after their civil war. You know, asking all kinds of questions, trying to figure shit out. Like, you're just a colonel? Why are you just a colonel? And the guy's like, I don't know. And he's like, hey, what's your name? He's like, I'm not a name? What's the name? He has some numbers to represent them. She keeps pressing and questioning, and it's described that he, like, because, you know, they always wear gas masks. You don't really see Kriegsman's face or what they look like, but it was described that she kept pressing him, like, what's your name? Yeah, you had to have a name. Your parents had to call you something. And it was described like he was almost confused. Like, he looked and he paused and he's like, my name's Jurgen. See what's going on? You get it? You understand? So my running theory, I hadn't looked at anything else. My running theory is that every fucking Kriegsman is a clone of Colonel Jurgen. Every fucking Kriegsman is Colonel Jurgen cloned. The Viete wound that makes people grow fast, he's the original copy. That's awesome. I love that. It's a great fucking thing to add in there. They're all just as zealous, and they give a fuck about the Emperor enough. They're willing to make those sacrifices, and nobody else is, just like Colonel Jurgen was. Colonel Jurgen loved Krieg, he loved his people, but they were traitors, so he nuked the whole goddamn planet. He loved his kids, he loved his daughter, he loved the children of Krieg just as much as the traitors did. But that was their whole point, right? And I'm like, yeah, we're traitors, they kill our children. But he loved the children of Krieg just as much as they did. However, they're just one soldier. In the grand scheme of things, they're one fucking soldier. He is one soldier. He's one hell of a soldier. That's why they fucking cloned him. But it doesn't matter. They all see it, as you know, Sergeant Rennick said. The Krieg saw it better than any of us. They saw it more clearly than any of the rest of us did. In life, war, and death, peace. In life, shame, and death, atonement. They fight for the greater good of everybody. They are the way they are. They suffer the way they are. They don't take off their fucking gas mask. They fight zealously. They die in droves. And not pointlessly. It's not a pointless death. Everything you do has a point to it. And it's all just so that they can atone for the civil war they had in the past and make sure the Emperor or the Astra Militarum, humankind, period, moves on. They're not mutated. Which, you know, the thing that Pharaoh's trying to bring up, oh, are you mutated? You know, and most people couldn't even, like, fucking do what y'all do. Now, that mutated, just loyal. And is it loyal? See, because the way their society is, where they all got that little fucking spark of Jurgen in them, that dogmatic fucking loyalty to, you know, their fellow man. Even though he cared about Creed, he cared about his people, but he cared about mankind as a whole a lot fucking more. You know, this book was fantastic. Steve Lyons needs a fucking round of applause, because this is some good shit. It makes you think a little bit. There's other characters in the book, obviously, I didn't go over too much, but... yeah, it's just a damn good fucking book, and I love the new lore that... That's what I was going to say, too, because... it described... I didn't get to this part. It described that Van Buren had to, like... He had some, like, special access codes to look at the fucking interview with the other Inquisitor that first... you know, touch down on Krieg and question the fucking Kriegsman going like, "My name's Jordan," in a confused tone. Because they're all given numbers. They're born, they get a fucking designation like, you know, "I'm fucking 3721. That is me. That's my name. I'm 3721. But no, they're all fucking, they're probably all Jordan. They're all just clones of fucking Colonel Jordan. They're all probably like 7, 10, 8 years old, you know, in reality. They grow up, they go through fucking training, and then they get shipped off to worlds to fight, to atone for the fact that their people fucked up, you know, thousands of years ago. I love the Death Corps of Greed. It does hurt my heart a little bit that there are people out there that see the gas mask and uniform, all that, and think, "Oh, Nazi." I mean, I've heard of people, same thing with commissars, you can't even, like, the people, you can't go to certain, like, Normacon, and the people look at this shit and be like, they don't have that historical context to think more about it, other than, "Oh, this kind of looks like a fucking Nazi. Are you a Nazi? Is that what you support?" No, it's not. Like I said, same thing, Comfort. They got that black, red, sleek look. Looks like not as uniform, but it's not. And it's really hard to describe how fucking cool this motherfucker is. Why is he cool? I mean, it's not just his appearance that is fucking cool. It's a lot of it, Comstar's too, for me. A lot of this has to do it for me. It's just that really hard fucking loyalty to something. I wish more than anything I was that loyal to fucking anything. I'm a communist. I love America. I'm not this goddamn loyal. I don't believe in any fucking cause so single-mindedly. Which is, you know, that's a problem. You shouldn't be, like, inflexible with your fucking thoughts and that shit at all. It's a lot like Van Buren, you know, like Van Buren, like everybody else, like, "Are you fucking heretics, Krieg? Why are you freaky? Why are you like this? Are you mutants? Are you, what's up? You're not normal. What's wrong with you?" But Van Buren understood that inflexibility and the way they think was just loyalty. That more than anybody else, they gave a fuck about their fellow man. So when their partner drops and dies, he's dead. I mean, he's gone. There's no reason to go over there, pray, you know, weep, be sorry for him. And they probably are deep down inside. He describes the colonel, and he said that all Kriegsmen have something like this. They have some kind of memento, something that makes them feel, I can't remember how to describe it. It wasn't human, but it makes them feel, it fills their soul up. Stuff I need, you know, that's why I need life. I need something to fill my soul. I drink coffee. Fills my chest up. And he had a little thick, very intricate box inside of it, just bones of some guy that died, but did a lot for him. But they gave a fuck about other people. And when their partners die, there's no time to weep for them. There's still a fight. Mankind's still in danger from monsters, Xenos, orcs, Eldar, which is where they go next. They're supposed to go and fight some Eldar next. That siege regiment that was on the original place where the present timeline where everybody's fighting at, fighting orcs at. There's no time to weep for them. There's a fight to go on. And somebody can use that fucking equipment that soldier dropped to pick up the equipment and fight. you fighting. Because people still need help out there. There are other people. There are good, loyal people to the Emperor, to their cause, to all their people that still need help. So they go out there and help them. A complete sacrifice to their own humanity, one might say. But you know what makes them happy? Makes them happy to atone. To know that their people fucked up once and caused other people grief. It is Colonel Jordan's will that they go and right those fucking wrongs and rewrite them again. Even though at this point, especially millennia in the future, after their fucking civil war, they've probably saved thousands, hundreds of thousands of planets full of fucking people on their own at the sacrifice of their singular planet that didn't even affect anything else in the galaxy. But because they did it, they fucked up at one point. They will forever have that cult of sacrifice mindset where they were going to do whatever is necessary to fucking win. It's not, you know, they talk about the Commissars having to pull the Kriegsmen back when they do suicide charge. It's not a suicide charge. It's not fucking suicidal. Shove them in the side. They're just dedicated to get in there and fucking kill the enemy. Kill the enemy to mankind. Kill the enemy to their comrades that are there or are not there. So they understand what the mission is. Because everybody's just one fucking soldier. Kinda. I mean, yeah, like the Inquisitor and shit, they're clearly more important, but they're gonna do what needs to be done to fucking win. There's a guardsman who jumped in for the fucking flame when somebody threw it at Van Buren. Why'd he do that? Because Van Buren was the only person who knew what the mission was. So he's more important than him. They don't have any fucking ego. They don't have a pride about their shit. Matter of fact, they're ashamed. Kriegsmen are ashamed of who they are and why they're like this. All because they fucked up, their people fucked up in the past. The only thing they want is to atone and put things back right and help their fellow man. There's just such a... this is not why they're fucking cool, not this uniform. It is. Trust me, it is. It's pretty badass. But it's that dedication to just their fellow man, period. Not their fucking fellow Cadian, not their fellow black man, not their fellow Nazi, not their fellow, you know, higher up. It's just mankind, period. They are loyal to men, to humans. There's a fantastic scene I love. I think it's a Death Rider or something. They're going through the catacombs. They find a mutant. You know, they get into a fight with the mutant for whatever reason. Because from the mutant's perspective, the mutant attacks them. He throws fire at them, runs up, tries to kill them. You know, they shoot him down. The mutant, you know, shrieks and hits his knees. And all he sees is, you know, the fucking gas mask. It was a skull gas mask. That's what the grenadiers wear and shit. And he's like, oh, I'm dead. This is death. This is a monster coming to kill me, the mutant. And, I can't remember if the mutant or the Kriegsman asked him, he's like, why? And the basic conversation ends up going, is like, the Kriegsman's like, you know, atone right now. Say you love the Emperor. Okay, I really want to pick up the book and find that scene, because it was so well written. It's like, you know, you're sorry, right? You know? You got a bad. He was basically saying you got a bad draw. You're a mutant, but I know you didn't pick to be a mutant. You're still loyal to the Emperor, right? You know, the mutant's like, yes. And I love the Emperor. Something about the Emperor. And then the Kriegsman kills him. Killed the mutant. Because it wasn't that mutant's fault that he's no longer human. That was a loyal citizen of mankind. He was a man that just got unlucky. So the Kriegsman did the merciful thing, and he took him out of that pain. Because it did describe that the only reason that mutant was even out and got caught out like that is like his skin was burning. He felt burning. His back hurt. His spine was twisted and shit. He got unlucky, and the Kriegsman wanted to make sure that he was right with their god before, you know, he took him out. He gave him that opportunity. Shit like that is why they're cool. It's their loyalty to The loyalty to their fellow man is why Krieg is cool. At a complete detriment of himself. Anyway, this video's went on way longer than I thought it was going to, but this is a fantastic book. Very short. You should read it, 10 out of 10. Again, the stuff with Curtis Yard is a little dry toast to me because it could have been a lot more elaborate going into like what made the Krieg the way they are, but stuff about Colonel Gurdon's sins and shit is just fantastic. Definitely read this book. You're gonna want more when you're done. You're gonna be hurting like fuck. I need more of this. Like it's 295 pages. It is not enough. 296 technically. It's not enough. Fucking. It's not enough. You want more. Anyway, this is Monica. This was Krieg by Steve Lyons. Thank you, Mr. Lyons, and you guys have a good one. Goodbye.